Hello. Today it is about BCA curves again, and I will code an example so you can watch me do what I'm doing to make a cookie cutter. And first of all, you want to get the file modules and examples from GitHub, and you can find it in the repository that is linked to in the description box. So you get yourself that file and copy it, rename it to whatever you want. In this video, I will make a cactus. Therefore, the file is named cactus. And I will go over it briefly so you can get acquainted with it and see what we are going to do. So first of all, you have this variable section where fs is the size of the little edges, straight edges that make curves. So a round thing in computer graphics is not really round, but it's made of tiny straight things, and fs is the size of those straight things, roughly. W1 and W2 are the width of the cookie cutter. Like W2 is the smaller side where you cut, and W1 is the larger side where you push. And for W2, I recommend two sizes, like twice your nozzle. So if you use a 0.4 millimeter nozzle, you can use 0.8 millimeter width there. This is going to make a good cookie cutter. And H is the height of the cookie cutter. So depending on what you want to bake, you might want to make it smaller than 15 millimeters. We will look into the points and example things later and look at the functions and modules. So in line 26, 6, and 27, those are functions that calculate the numbers of edges of things. Fn is used for Bezier curves, and Fn circle is used for circle-ish things like that are actually on a round circle. The module shape is like the basic shape that everything is made of, which is a cylinder that is as high as your cookie cutter height, h, and as wide as W1 and W2. Both ends. The module straight line is not going to be used in this cookie cutter because it is round everywhere. But I left this in here because I think it's good for teaching. Because everything that we do is in the end going to be hull around two of those basic shape things in different places. That's it. That's it, what all the cookie cutters are made of. And then there is this circle-ish module that is not going to be used in the cactus, but you can use it for other things. And I also left it in here. Like I left it in here because I always start from this models and function file, but I also left it in a tutorial. Because it works well to explain what I'm doing. Fn is optional. So you can use the functions with radius and angle and possibly Fn. If you want to, you can use this Fn if you want to make, for instance, an octagon. Then you don't need to make several straight shape things, but you can use this circle-ish function a module for this. But you can also leave it out, and then it will make a round thing on its own. It would call will call once again a hull around basic shapes in different places, and that's what it does. So now we're getting to the Bezier things. This is the module that we will call like all the time. And it is given an array of points. That's what it does. And it will call this other function that we will go on over right now. And in the end, it once again makes hulls around lots of basic shapes in different points. That's what it does. And it gets the exact points from calling this other function. And this this one gets called by the function above, but also from the rainbow function. And it gets this array of points, PTS, and two numbers. And it's a recursive function, so it asks, are the points more than 2 points? And if yes, it calls itself twice. And if no, it does basically the thing that I've explained in the Bézier curve video. It takes 2 points and it adds 1 point times something to another point times something. Yes. So the rainbow function also calls the B points function, but it does not create a hull. It just draws a lot of spheres into the place and it makes them very colorful. So it gets a couple of points and it makes spheres located on a Bézier curve. That's basically what it does. And the rainbow, without any Bézier, just paints colorful points in places. Yes, so it just makes spheres into places. We will use that too. Yes. So let's render, or at least preview it and have a look. Oh. So, from line 18, we get this thing that is here in the front, which is like circle-ish, but with four sides. So we're using this fn function. And next to it, the smaller round thing, is a circle-ish thing with calculated fn. You can still see that it has this hull around two basic shapes, and the rounder one just has very many of those that are roughly 1 millimeter apart, as described in FS. On the other side, we see this weird S-shaped thing. And this is made in line 20 from a B-curve module. And this is what we will actually make. We will make Bézier curves that have these hull around basic shape things many, many times and be creative and make weird curves with those. The rainbow things can be seen better from the lower side. And the round thing is made from line 21, which is the circular shape, and the S-shaped curvy curly thingy is made from line 22. Notice that it has 5 points, which is more than we usually use in Bézier curves. Like most of the time for cookie cutters, I would use 4 points, like 4 point Bézier curves. And then there's also a rainbow thing in line 23, and it paints those individual points. Like if you want to have a couple of points, make them visible somewhere, you can conveniently use this rainbow function. And now we can delete this code. And start to write our own file. The thing is, when I write OpenSCAD, I think in terms of code, and I don't think very visually. And therefore, I often end up drawing a sketch by hand before I start coding. In case of a cookie cutter, we have the advantage that we want to build something that is two-dimensional in the end. So we can use an SVG file. So either you can make your own file, or you can download a Creative Commons licensed SVG file that looks like the cookie cutter or looks like the shape that you want to build. So I have a cactus SVG in the same folder, and I will import it. Let's see. Mm-hmm. There's no cactus. Oh, yes. There is it. The thing is, it's just much bigger than we need to, because the cookie is supposed to be like this, maybe, and not like, what? 40 centimeters. Like, that's a large cookie. Okay, so we'll scale it down. Let's see. Let's see what we have. Okay. So this is maybe a bit tiny because the arms are already quite small, and if they are too small, you cannot bake it or it will fall apart when you bake it. So maybe like that. Yeah. So that is a 9 centimeter tall cookie, which is rather large, but I think it is what we need, because otherwise the arms are just too thin. Which I think is an important remark about what cookie cutters work best. It works better with somewhat compact shapes. If they have too small details, the cookie will fall apart. And this is this shape is already quite a bit adventurous, but why not? It certainly works well in terms of irregular, curvy things, and that's what we wanted. So the next thing we're going to do is to find the points that will be the ends of the curves. Like to find the points at the extremes. And I'm going to start here and go like this way around. And on that side, it's a little bit unclear. I'm not entirely sure where I will place the points yet. Certainly there will be a point because that's an extreme point, and there. And then here, probably there, where the curve changes from being curved that way to curved that way, like at the S-shaped point, there's certainly going to be a point. But the question is, somewhere here on this side, there should be a point. Maybe there. And then there. And I already see that this curve, like that is quite pointy for a curve. And so that might be a candidate for a 5-point curve, but we will see. Yes, so I will go around and build the curves like that. We will do it together for 3 or 4 points, and then I will leave you alone because this is really boring, but just to show you what I'm doing. So we have P1. So this is something at 50 and 80. And then we have a 0.2. And this is something like, I don't know, 60 and 60, roughly. And I wanted to point here, right? So that would be roughly 45 and 42, maybe. So now it's estimates, okay? 45 and 42. And a point here, which is like 40 and 32. And one here, which is like 28 and 0. And then we will look at them. Oh, wrong. Let's see. Okay. So those dots are quite a bit small. They are hard to see. So we'll go here and make them a bit larger. Okay. So that's something we can work with. And now I will just correct the points. So this one is a little bit more up and also a little bit more to the right. Yes, that is cool. The next one is a little bit more in, so it's like, go for 59 and a little lower. Let's see. A bit more like that. Close enough. You can also do 58.5. Unlike in some typography tools, you don't necessarily need to use integer here. Like you can use whatever number. So the next one is tricky. The one at the S shape, it's certainly lower. Let's go for 43. No, that was wrong. Let's try this. Yeah, much better. A tiny bit lower, 40.5 maybe. Yeah, that looks all right. The next point should be a little lower and a little more out. Yeah, that looks good, and that looks good too. You can also zoom in and see what we have been doing. And it's also, I mean, it's a cookie cutter. It doesn't need to be 100% perfect, but you need to find those extreme points. I'll stop filming now and come back when I made the other points. Now I added all the points, as you can see. And I want to mention a decision that I took. Like I said, I made a point here, which is like the middle of the S-shape curve. And I did something similar on the other side. But I didn't do that here. Like here you have an S-shaped curve with no point in the middle to it. And I think I don't need it there because it doesn't need to be as exactly. I mean, this is not typography. It doesn't need to be like very, very specific. It just needs to be a curve somehow. Because, I mean, is this a cactus at all? It's debatable. So the next step will be to add those points that make the curves curvy. And I will start here again. So I will figure out two points between those two. And I decided to call them P1A and P1B. P1A. And we already know the x value of one of those and the y value of the other, because the P1A is supposed to be at the same height as P1, and P1B is supposed to be like somewhere here in this line, which makes it easier. I will add them to the list of points that will be shown. P1A, P1B. And then we also need to see the curve that it creates. Like, we need to create a curve and need to make it visible. And we will use this other B curve rainbow function. Module. For I hope I'm using this right. No, it needs to be an array of points, right? So like that. P1, P1A, P1B, and P2. Because that's the curve that we're going to make. So let's say about P1, we already know the y value, and we need to figure out an x value, and it needs to be like a little bit bigger than P1. So let's say 55 and 81. And about P1B, we already know the x value, and we need to guess the y value, and it needs to be bigger than of P2. So let's go with 58.5 and, I don't know, 65 maybe? And let's see what we get. Aha! So, need to zoom in because this is really a bit hard to see. However, we have a curve at all, which is great. And it is too much inwards here, which means that this point needs to go out further. It shouldn't go out wider than above the other point, because that makes odd things. But we already know where we have to go to. Let's go for 57. Yeah, this is already pretty good. Yeah, maybe a little more. 58. Nah, that's too much. And we will just increase the y value of those to make it closer to the thing. Ah, yeah. That's pretty good. So that's what we're looking for. Between all the points that we have, we always need two or three more points to create such a curve. And with the rainbow thingy, we can see that it's approximately where the curve of the original shape is. So, everywhere where we have points at the extremes, like here, it's like the most right point, and here's the most top point at this curve. We already have a given x value for one of the points and y value for the other points. But here, this is a bit tricky, because We don't need a point that's exactly here. It will make a wrong curve. We need a point that has a slope that is a little bit like that. Okay? So it's not exactly that or that, but it's a little bit straight. I didn't have that problem before because I never made something complicated like this cactus. I always had the points at the extremes and could do the models with that. This is why I wrote a new function, in which you can see here, which calculates a point with a slope. And I think this is useful in this case because we need the same slope on both sides of this point. Yeah, it needs like on this side we need a point that is on the same slope like on the other side to create this curve and to create the other curve. And so it's easier to find both points precisely if we use this function. And like I said before, in OpenSCAD, it doesn't need to be integer. And also, OpenSCAD is very good at calculating float values, like better than most programming languages. I don't know how they do it, but it works really well. So we can make weird numbers. We can create weird numbers with that, and it's going to work. So now I will use that on this curve. We will have 2 points. B2A and B2B. P2A and P2B. And, oh, this is not even, yeah. P2A is going to have an x and y value like before. And P2B is going to use this slope function thing. We will also use the rainbow thing with all the other points to draw the curve. And add those points here. Okay, so here, once again, we need something that has the same x value as the point before, 8.5, and a lower y value. Let's go for 55, and here, we need this slope function thing. So this is new and exciting. And the variables that we'll get is P3, because that's where we calculate from. Like we need this point and then some slope and some difference in x. What is going to be the difference in x? Well, we have to just guess a number. I'll put 5. And the slope, well, I will start with 0.1. Because it's like it's not steep. Like it's really, but I don't know what we're getting here. We will see. P3 in file cactus line 18. Okay, what's the matter here? Oh, this is interesting. All right, so the problem is that it can't calculate this because it needs something that comes afterwards. So we just need to swap the location. I had that before. That's a really, really weird bug. Let's see. Ah, so. Now we have got a curve, which is far too much inside. So, let's go for low. So I'll put down this point, okay, by lowering the Y value by 5 millimeters. Yeah, we're getting there. It should be even lower, 45 maybe. Yes. And then we will increase the distance here to pull this this point a bit more to the right. Yeah, that's pretty good. I think I will. We see some of the yellow stuff here, which is not supposed to happen. And I'm not quite sure. Maybe this point is too high. But this point might also be too high. I will decrease the slope a little bit. Let's see. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. But I'll also decrease the Y value of 0.3. Like that. Yeah. That's good. That's really good. And now we will make up this point, which once again uses this slope calculated value. And I hope this should be a straight one. Okay. So P3A and P3B. What am I doing here? I'm getting tired. Maybe I shouldn't code now. Oh, and this is again with slope. And now we're. This is already. It's already this slope again with P3, except that the x difference thing is a negative value and the slope is the same. So it is P3. It is, I don't know, -3 and 0.08. And here we need the same x value as P4, which is 40.5 and a higher Y value. Let's go for 35. The initial values I'm mostly guessing. I guess you've noticed that. So first I just guess values. Then I look at the curve and then I continue from there. Okay. We need to add those points here. P3A and P3B. And we also need such a rainbow thingy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's actually really cool. In order to see the points better and to see better what I'm doing, I will increase FS just a little bit. So we have less dots and we can see the space between the dots better. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, that's a really nice curve. I will do one more because I really don't know what's going to happen here with this weird curve. I think, like I said before, I think this will be a 5-point curve. So that's how I'm doing it. So it will be P4A. And there's no weird slope thing because this is really, this is a straight line and this is a straight line, and a point that is very much in the middle, we really have to find by hand. There's no shortcut, I guess. We will have to deal with that. P4B. And P4C. And we will add those here. And we will have this once again. 4 P 4 C and P5. All right. So this one has the same X value like P4 for the dot 5. Then we just need to guess. And this needs to be smaller than 31. Let's say 40. Here, I will just put it in the corner here, okay? And start from there. We will see what happens, which would be 40.5 and 0. Here, we already know that we will have the same y value as P5 and an x value that is, I don't know, like 35 or something. So let's go for 35 and 0 and see what we get. Okay. So we will definitely pull this point down quite a lot. Where even is it? Oh, I had a mistake. This should be lower, not higher. Let's look. Aha, yes. That is much more like it. Yeah. I'll put it down a lot more. Because this is really a weird shape. Yes, yes. I'll pull it down a lot more. And this point. Those points are so much together here because that's where they all are, but this curve is boring anyway, so we don't need to have so many steps here, so this is kind of all right. But I will totally go for a higher point here. Yeah. That's much more like it. But I want to see the points. That's why I increase FS once again, just so you can see what I'm doing. I somewhat want to have it more angular. Yeah. But this already pulls out here and there. So I think that's what we get. If I want to have this more exact, I need to have an end point in this place. But in this case, I will deal with it because it's just a cactus. And so I don't need to be too uptight about this curve, yeah. In the end, all the other things work the same. And so I will do that on my own again, and you can do it on your own again. So I will figure out the other points for the other curves, and then I'll start recording again. So now we have all the points. And this is great, because this is most of the work. Some comments about it. Here we also had an S shape. I wasn't aware of that before. I kept those S shapes in one curve, so I didn't split them up into two curves. Though those last ones are written in 5-point curves here. Also, the last curve obviously ends in P1 here. Whether or not you want to split up a curve into two or make those 5-point curves, yeah, you have to figure out what works best for you and how exactly you want to have it. In the end, there's no rules how you have to do it. Sometimes you have to take a decision. Now we can remove the things we don't need anymore, and we can change those modules, B curve rainbow, into B curve. And then we will have a cookie cutter, which is amazing. I'll do that just now. Thank you for your patience. Oop. And don't need that. This might take a while. Aha! There we go. We have our cactus cookie cutter. It's really nice. And I guess it's actually smooth enough for a cookie cutter, because the cookie dough is not like, it's not a precision material. It's not like metal. It changes shape anyway with baking, but if you want to have those things smoother, you have to go to FS again. So you could make FS 0.5 maybe. Let's see how long that takes for calculating. Ah, it's not too bad. It actually does something. Yeah, so as you can see, this makes a very smooth cookie cutter. And whenever your calculation is too slow, you can always just play with this value. Now we can refactor a little bit. We probably don't need this. And we don't need this and this and this. So many things. And we don't need all the rainbow stuff. Let's see whether it's still true. Oh no! Yeah. Oh yeah, this is very bad. Very, very bad of me. Because now we have to wait through the rendering. I might delete that from the video. So what happened was that accidentally I commented out the shape thing, which is used in all the points. But yeah, let's just do it again. There is our cactus. So now we know what we don't need and can delete those. So we can understand our own code better if we need to, without all the unnecessary stuff. So, this is the render. Yes. So, that's it. That's the cookie cutter and the whole process. I'm not entirely sure. Maybe I should make a third video about the cookie cutter things and show some of the functions that and some of the other options, many things that you can do with cookie cutters that are not in a video yet. On the other hand, I think they're fairly trivial. So if you look up the files that I have, you can find other ideas. However, if you have questions, put them into the description box, and then I might make another video about things that people want to hear about. Yeah, thanks for now. Thanks for your patience. This was a very long video, very unusual for me. Have a good time and see you. Bye.